views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests and not necessarily those of the staff and management of WWDB-TV.
Hello, and welcome to the latest edition of Real Talk with Rick Mannarino. We're going to deviate from the show a little bit this week. We're going to do something a little different. As you know, I generally have a guest that has some interesting information about their business or themselves or things that they are working on. And it's just always a show about influencers and things that are people doing great in society, like the SPCA and the various people that I had, No Drugs to America, No Drugs America, these type of shows. Today the show is going to be a little different. I invited one of my fellow speakers and a great guest, John DeMartino, who speaks all over the world with me and a lot of motivation, leadership for sales. And I invited him to be on the show because I have a big presence on Instagram and YouTube and some of these other areas, Facebook. And I had a post the other day that I posted, and it said, "I am fearless." Mm. I am fearless. Okay. And I got incredible response on it. Thousands of people were on there saying, "Oh, that's great, I love it." And you know, and I had a little bit of information below it saying, you know, you've got to overcome fear and so forth. And I thought, wow, what a great subject to talk about today. Get a little different on the show. Just have a discussion about the word fear, fearless. And how I wanted to start is that we are all have some type of fear. There's nobody that doesn't have fear. Fear of failure, fear of death, fear of being able to handle their finances, fear of feeding their children. Whatever it is, we all have fear within us. And I post something, "I am fearless," because that's reiterates in my mind, that reconfirms in my mind that I have to act fearless, but I have fears. I have, you know, many types of fears that I overcome, but by saying to myself and reconfirming it and putting it through my mind daily, "I am fearless," but that's what I attempt to be. And we all attempt to be that. But for anybody to be, "Oh, I'm fearless," well, I think that's a little bit not realistic, because we all have fear. But I wanted to bring John on today because I wanted to get your thoughts on that. It really brought a lot of information, a lot of people interested on my Instagram, and all 99% positive. I just wanted to get your thoughts on "I am fearless."
Yeah, no, I think it's although it's, you know, two words, it carries a lot of weight, because everybody has fear. It is disingenuous to say that you're never scared, or you don't fear anything. You don't, but we know that that's not true. But it's how you handle it is what's important. So, you know, do you let fear make you a victim and take your power away, so you don't even get in the race? So how are you supposed to win the race if you don't even enter it? But fear is powerful, and if you can't control it, if you know, look at a UFC fighter. They're going in there half naked. They're fighting in front of their friends, family, and millions of people around the world. And you don't think they have a fear of getting knocked out in 30 seconds? That's embarrassing. But they have to harness that fear and put something else in their head that's going to start to move them down a different road, where they start that fear becomes energy. That fear becomes something that's going to drive them. And how I look at it is, growing up, you know, I had, you know, I just had a lot of preconceived notions and boundaries in my head that caused me to have some fear going into sales and doing presentations, because I was always told, you know, I come from Brooklyn, so your Brooklyn accent, you sound stupid. It sounds dumb. Be quiet. Don't, you know what, you have two ears and one mouth. Listen more than you talk. Be quiet. All the shows on TV, you know, they, all the dumb guys were the guys with the Brooklyn accent. So when I first went on Wall Street, when I was working as a stockbroker, I was nervous to talk on the phone because I thought people were going to say I was stupid. And so that's a fear. It's a fear of rejection, a fear of being ridiculed. There's a lot of that. But what started to happen is I realized I started to fear not being successful more than the fear of maybe looking bad. Because the reality is, no matter who you are, when you first start, you can't be great from day one. You can be good, you can show potential, yes, but you wouldn't be the Rick you are today without the journey you've went through. We all have to start at a starting point and become great. And so once that fear, you have to realign it, and that's how you use fear. That's what that means. How do you do that? You start to fear not being successful. You start to fear not having financial security or family security or fear of not taking care of your kids. And once you do that, then you start to realize, okay, am I nervous or am I excited to go up and speak in front of people? It's a little tweak, but it removes the fear out of it, and you're using that fear now in a way of excitement. Are you afraid to talk on the phone because you may sound a certain way, or are you more fearful that you're not going to speak to enough people to, you know, attain your dreams? Don't let it hold you back. So that's kind of how I look at it.
You know, it's interesting that the point you made, fear of failure. And I can speak for myself. As a young man, I grew up in a very, very athletic family. And my brothers and sisters, you know, there were five of us, all great athletes but me. And I was the oldest, and I was not a great athlete. And they kind of used to make fun of me. I mean, if we played Little League Baseball, and I was a 12-year-old, which is the maximum in Little League Baseball, I was sitting on the bench, and my 10-year-old brother was making the All-Star team and being a star. So I actually didn't feel that I deserved to be successful. I feared success. I feared it. And the funny thing about it is, and so many people have this problem, you unintentionally, you don't even know it, subconsciously, you build up roadblocks. I found that I'd start to become successful at something, and I would set up something to make me fail, and I would continue to fail. I literally had fear of success. I wanted to fail because in my family, I was an athletic failure. The funny thing about that is that I took that and took that fear eventually and said, listen, I deserve to be successful. I deserve to have success. So I went out and worked and worked and worked and became the best athlete in the family. I was the one that went on and had a great college football career. None of them played beyond high school, maybe a little college. And it was at that point I realized you have to believe. You have to believe. You have to overcome that fear that says, I have a fear of failure. And so many people have it. And what are some of the fears that you've had in your life that you've had to overcome, John?
So one of the things that was the biggest fear for me, and it's crazy because every time I tell somebody what my biggest fear is, they almost look at me in disbelief, and they're like, no way, you're just saying that because that I have that. And I'll tell you what it is, but the funny thing is because I had it opposite. So athletics came, I played baseball from 5 years old, football from 8. I quarterbacked, I pitched, I played shortstop. I mean, I always played MVP of the league, moved up to my brother's division, even though he was 4 years older than me. So I always very much excelled at that, right? All city, Brooklyn All-Stars, all that stuff. When I was on the football field, I had no fear of failure because I knew I was better than who I was going to be playing. I knew that I was going to elevate my team. I just knew it. We popped open those doors, ran out on the field, and I just felt confident. I didn't win every game, but I could have. I felt like I could have. I felt like we could have as a team. So when I got into even, you know, working on Wall Street, I didn't have a problem kind of talking one-on-one like we're doing now, right? The biggest fear I had was make other people hearing what I was saying, right? And part of it, I think it was because of the boundaries I put in my head, but public speaking to me was the absolute I had a physical effect in my body that not only would I start sweating, but my mouth would get dry, my legs would almost feel weak, I would just go blank. And I was so nervous that if I had to do anything like this, I would literally go to people and tell them, do I look nervous? I'm really nervous. I'm just telling everybody how scared I was because I wanted someone to be like, oh, it's okay. You know what? Sit down. We'll do it. It just made me do things that I would never do. And like you said, I built boundaries in my head so strong. I kind of encased myself. And it wasn't until literally into my late 30s that I got over it. And now you have to realize that during this time, I was literally, for Colonial Bank, I was over the brokerage team for the state of Nevada. And I look back on it and I say, how much further could I have been if I would have just overcame that fear, if I didn't let the fear make me a victim? And it's just, it was an odd thing because I'm so competitive that usually it's like whatever it is, it's on. I don't care if what it doesn't matter what it is. I want to win, yeah. Right? So what I did was it took me a very long time until I had a really good mentor who said, why are you telling everyone how scared you are? Yeah. He goes, you could have came in here and been whoever you wanted to be. You could have told me you were the best speaker ever. And I wouldn't know any better, right? But you came in here and that shows me what the boundaries you've set. So I started to, once he said that, and it's common sense, right? But when you're going through, you don't know it. And he connected that dot. And I said back then, I said, what I'm going to do is make my biggest weakness my biggest strength. And I sit here today, and I went through a journey. I went through some crazy close calls that I was just going to back way out of it. But I now speak all over the place. I help sales teams. I speak in front of hundreds and hundreds of people, trained hundreds, if not thousands, of salespeople throughout my career. But now I am able to do this, and what I love about it, Rick, is that instead of teaching you one-on-one and being quiet, now I'm up in front of a room and I'm teaching 50, 100, 500 salespeople at one time. And how I look at it is I'm not speaking to 500 people. I'm having 500 individual conversations. It's just happening at one time. And so I'm able to impact so many more people. And this journey that we're on, I'm happy that I was able to overcome it, number one. And number two, great that me and you have the friendship we have. And as brothers, we go out there and make sure we're always lifting each other up. And that's really good to have. If you don't, you want to find somebody who's going to lift you up, not suck that energy out of you. So I think that's
yeah, great. It's interesting because it brought to mind a thing that you've said to me several times. You say, Rick, the one thing that is amazing to me about you, Rick, is that your confidence level is incredible. And we've talked about that, and we've talked about the fear of being confident, but you've overcome that, and now you have that confidence. You've built that confidence, but it was a fear. And one of the things I want to talk about, one of the examples I'd like to use is my young daughter, Maya, who will tell me, Dad, I'm afraid to do something. I'm fearful about this test. I'm fearful about this ball game that I'm going to be playing in. I have fear of it. I'm nervous. It uses the word nervous a lot. Fear, nervous, they go hand in hand. And I said to her, when you have that fear and you have that nervousness, it means you're ready. When you feel that in the pit of your stomach, that fear, that nervousness, it means you're ready. And what we do a lot of, I mean, I feel fortunate. There's very few things that I fear. My biggest thing, and when you talk about your biggest fear, my biggest fear was I became very successful. I set up, you know, the checks and balances for myself to not be fearful and become successful. And an incredible 30-year career marketing business, successful year after year, always climbing. My biggest fear always was the fear of failure, that I was going to become fail in business and be not financially stable enough to support my family after I had made all that money. Yeah. And the funny thing is, in 2010, it happened to me. That fear that I had that I was going to fail at some point in my life and not be successful in business and not be able to feed my family, that fear came. It came because the real estate market fell apart. My businesses fell apart. My real estate holdings went to hell. Stock market, things like that, racehorses. Well, all of a sudden I lost everything. But I realized that fear that I had all that time, when it happened to me, I said, okay, this has happened. That fear, I ended up making it happen, of failure like that. I made it happen. But once it happened, I said, let's get back.
Yeah.
Let's not be fearful. Let's build the career again. Mm-hmm. Let's be successful again. Let's go forward. But I mean, how many people do you know that they have the fears? I mean, some people have such incredible fear of things that they don't even go out of the house. They wake up. They're fearful of what's going to happen during the day. They're fearful that they're not going to be successful. They're going to fear the fact somebody's not going to tell them they're beautiful or relevant or have great things about them. Do you deal with any people like that that show fear? Or how do you work with your kids? I guess that would be the answer. You have a bunch of kids. I have a bunch of children.
Yeah.
And we take a lot of pride in raising great citizens.
Oh, yeah.
How do you help them overcome fear?
Yeah, so, you know, one of the things that I think is a big thing is taking ownership of it. And so depending on the age of your child, so we have, our daughters are close in age, but I have kids that go up to 31. You have very adult children too. One of the things I think is really important, and I try to set the example, is, you know, through that collapse in, you know, from 2010, 2011, Colonial Bank went out of business. And so at first I was like, look at the markets collapsed. Right? Yeah. That's why I lost my brokerage business.
I know that.
And that's why, and that's why, and that's why. And so what I was failing to do is realize I was in that position because of choices I made, because I can't control the market any more than I can control the weather. So if I let the market be a reason why I can't succeed in my business, those are choices that I've made. And if I could own that, right, then I know it's something like, okay, this is what I did, but if I were to change my choices and built a residual book of business that would pay me out every year and not take a bigger chunk up front, then I would be recession proof. And like some of the stockbrokers did, they did that and they had big books. I had bigger books of business than most of them, but I didn't have it residualized, right? Mm-hmm. So I didn't have that 1% coming in every year. So even though they took big hits in their business, they were still making great money all the time. So what I do with my kids is, and again, you gotta be age appropriate depending on how old they are, but when they talk about what they're scared of, I try to get in at what were the choices you've made to get why you're scared. Most of the time, it's procrastination. Most of the time, they're self-sabotaging because they're so nervous about something that they put off studying for it. They put off preparing. They, whatever it may be, whether, you know, my son's in the military and he's also a resource officer for a school. And I watch him get prepared and it's very, very different. So when he goes into work, he goes in with, he has massive confidence in how he goes there. He takes it very, very serious, but he's getting his bulletproof vest. It's done and cleaned, whatever, hanging, he puts it on. All his equipment is where it needs to be. Everything is done the night before. He gets up, he puts everything on, everything is checked, everything is where it needs to be. He's prepared, he cleans his guns, his rifle, everything is just, everything is done that way. My other kids that aren't so regimented, they seem to have more fear when it comes to the stressful times. So you're gonna have a big test, you're gonna have an SAT, you're gonna take the bar exam.
Yeah, many things.
Because they're not prepared that way. So we talk about daily goals. What is your goal today? What is the end result you want for today? What do you wanna do? So my 10-year-old may say, I wanna really participate in PE today. Whatever it may be, that's because it's just about learning how to set those goals daily. And how are you going to achieve them? And it's not about that when you go play, this one is better, or I'm not faster than that one. It's, and I try to drill it in her head, what we do is we give 150%. We commit. We leave everything on the football field, right? And if we lose, I will still be proud of you. But if you win and you coast and you dog it and you just play, you don't care because your superior athletics takes over. Those guys, I don't have respect for people like that.
Yeah.
I have respect for the person who's gonna go in and give it everything they have every day. You know, you come in second place, you get a C, but you gave 150%, I will sing your praises. And so it's really about just doing your best and not worrying about what this other person's doing or what your brother or sister did. It's about, did you go out and do your best? Did you do yourself proud? Did you go out there with integrity and desire to win and be the best you can be? And if you did that, if you can look in the mirror and say you did that, then the choices you've made up to then are fine. And you know what? If you don't get that result, that doesn't mean you're not gonna get it next time. You give 100% because most people are not going to do that. They're going to lay back. And like you did, you outworked. Right? You
in
outwork.
End,
that's every story I hear that you tell me, it's about outworking. Just because you may turned into a good salesman, because I turned into a good salesman, I didn't sit back. I was at the brokerage houses. I can't tell you the amount of phone calls I was making. And the better I got, I didn't sit on the sideline. It's like you have a hot batter who hit 3 home runs in a row. What do you sit him on the bench because he's doing good? No, he's hot. Right? You open up an account. You open up 2 accounts, you open up 3 accounts, most of those stockbrokers, they go home, had a good day. Not me. I'd stay there later if I could. I'll sleep at that place because I know I'm hot. I got to ride the momentum.
Right.
So I think that's what, and I try to talk to my kids about that and set the example so they see. Hopefully the older ones set the example for the younger ones. But if they can do that, get those goals set and make good choices, I think fear will start to dissipate.
Yeah, it's such an interesting subject. And I know everyone in our audience today watching this, you've gone through moments of fear. We've all had moments of fear. I'm curious to find out. And, you know, please get back to us. Please check into us. Please come back and respond to us. And let us know how you overcome fear. Everybody overcomes fear differently. And I'm always curious to learn. I believe that we always need someone, that go-to person that helps us with our fearful moments. That one person that we talk to, or a few people that help us through it. Because I don't care how successful you are, how confident you are, how relevant you are in society, how much money you've made, it doesn't matter. We all have our fearful moments. I imagine that when a pastor is speaking in front of a big congregation, he has a fearful moment of, you know, what am I going to talk about today? How is it going to be accepted? Is it going to be controversial? Things like that. We all have moments where that fear does appear. And having that go-to person really helps. I've always been a guy, and it just sounds kind of like rhetoric, but just do it. That's always been my thing. Like, in a fearful moment, just do it. I can remember I went to a very small high school and was a football player there, and we were not had no relevancy in the football world. I decided I was going to go out for college football. I wanted to walk on and play college football. My friends, my family told me, Rick, are you kidding me? There's a couple hundred guys out there. They don't even know who you are. They don't even know who your high school is. You're going to go play college football? And that's really when I started to realize about overcoming fear. Mm-hmm. I went out for that football team. I was like seventh string. They were like, who is this guy?
Yeah, yeah.
Who is this guy? What's your name? Mannerino? Mad Dog Mannerino, they ended up calling me. Anyways, I ended up going out there, and I'm showing up every day, and I'm going through the workouts. And in summer camp, I'm going every day and just hustling. And all these superstars are just, you know, you're going through the motions in the summer. It's not football season yet. Lo and behold, football starts. And I become, within the first couple weeks, a starter. Not just on the team. I didn't just make the team. I became a starter, and then ended up having a very good football career. And I think to myself, wow, I became somebody that was really relevant when I could have said, I'm fearful, I'm listening to these people. And that's the other thing about fear. People get in your head, fear, fear, fear. All you hear is the word fear. You don't hear them saying, oh, you're not going to make it. Are you kidding me? You're going out for that ball club? And it's like, I always remember back to that experience, because that really set me on a course of success. And whenever things were fearful or they weren't going well, I'd always remember back to that moment. So this many years later, I still remember back to that moment. Do you have that moment where you decided, hey, I'm going to take fear on, I'm going to punch it in the face, and I'm going to handle it, and yes, I'm fearful, but I'm going to go out and be fearless? Do you have that moment?
Yeah. So, I'm going to tell you about this, and this is when I think I broke through the fear thing, and it's kind of a funny story because that shows how just nerve-wracked I was. But I just want to touch on a point you made, which is so important. If you stay with the wrong people and they're in your ear, they're always going to tell you they can't make it, you can't make it. Now, what are you, that's crazy. You're going to try and start a business? You're going to leave corporate America or your city job to go out and really get your piece of the American dream? If they're someone who's successful, you'll never hear them say that. They'll say, "Do you know what the, you know? The goods and bads. Did you do your research? You see, know the market trends, but go after it. You can do it, right?" But it seems like you get investment advice from your plumber, right? And it's like it's the weirdest thing. It's like, no, when I was in investments, I was like, "Why? What do you mean you're not moving forward with the investment?" Yeah, no, someone told me that this is not a great stock to be in, that he was, and I was, who was it? It was the plumber. We got to talking. And it's like, you have to be very, very cognizant of who's in your ear, who you're surrounding yourself with, because that's a lot of junk in your head. So that's a big one, because it can give you all these preconceived notions. But to go back to your original question, so, and this was a tough one. I almost didn't do it. I almost kind of wussed out. But what I did was I was at I had some experience in a multi-level marketing company back when. It was the person who I was dating at the time. She was big. right? She was dynamic in front of the room. Like I said, I had a fear of it. I wouldn't speak. They call me up, I'd walk and just walk out of the room. So years later, me and my wife were at a meeting, and it was her friends, and they were like, oh yeah, John, you used to be in this. Can you be our closing speaker and close the room? So what was I gonna say? No, right? So I'm like, yeah, no problem. And I literally felt like I had to change my underwear. I was so, I just had a visceral reaction almost immediately. So there was about 40 people in this woman's house, in this lady's house that we went to, again, my wife's friends and family. And I'm supposed to be the big closing speaker, and they don't know that I am petrified. I don't know what I'm gonna say. I don't know why I said yes. And I'm sitting next to my wife. The speaker before me was finishing up, and I put my arm like this, Rick, over my wife, and I said, and she looked at me, and I pulled my arm back. In that moment, what I was going to tell her was, honey, I'm going to the bathroom and then walking out the door. tell him I had an epileptic fit. I don't care what you tell him happened, but I'll be walking, pick me up beautiful. On the way home. And because of my wife makes me want to be a better man, and I wouldn't embarrass her that way, I stopped. And the fear of embarrassing her became greater of the fear of getting up in front of these people. So what happened was I get up in front of them, and it started just like it always had, sweating, dry mouth, and I'm talking from my head. It happened to be a company that was really into nutrition, and so we were talking about why be healthy, and what happened was, a strange thing happened. Everybody was sitting back. I started to speak from my heart about having a young daughter, about wanting to go and play with her and run with her, and why I thought this was good for nutritional benefits and whatever else you can get from it. And I started to speak from my heart, not only was I gaining confidence now rather than getting myself more down the rabbit hole, but I realized I just kicked fear in the ass, right? And I went up there, and who cares the reasons why I was up there, but when I started to speak from my heart, everybody started to sit up on their chairs and lean into me and really try to find, because you start to connect on a human level. But that was the time that it was that pivotal moment between I'm never going to conquer this, or I'm going to do it now, because I am not going to make my wife look bad.
And you soared from there.
And that's it. That was it.
You know, it's interesting. I can't help but think, as I'm sitting here, that one of the great determining factors in overcoming fear is prayer. I find that prayer is so, so very important. And many times I've been fearful about things. I can talk about my young daughter. When she was born, she had a lot of medical issues. And it was touch and go whether she was going to die. She was in a coma for 5 weeks. And I can remember I sat in that hospital with her with great fear that any day, any moment, she was going to pass. That to lose a child is an incredibly, incredibly tough thing. So I would pray every day to overcome that fear, that sweat that I would have. When I would go to bed, I wouldn't sleep, and I'd be in that hospital with her. And prayer was so, so instrumental in asking God for his help and to overcome what I had overcome. And it was great, because prayer does work. Self-confidence works. Just say, I'm going to do it. It's so very important. Self-belief is important, confidence. I really, really would like to hear from you all. How do you handle fear? Because everybody has a different way of doing it. If we don't handle it, we're not going to be successful in our lives, because we're going to live a life of paranoia, because we're afraid of everything, and everything brings us fear,
right,
and we don't move. So I really, really would like to hear from our audience of what are the ways that you overcome fear? I think that we all have it. I know that we all have it. And again, that post on Instagram, really, it hit me, because I posted, I am fearless. And of course, in the lines below, I said that this is my way of teaching myself to not be fearful about something. I am fearless. That's another check and balance I use. I am fearless. So going ahead, John, what are the type of things that you do to overcome your fear? Do you still have fear of speaking? Is it still a tough thing for you? Do you talk to some big audiences? Do you Do you fear things like there's going to be that person in the audience that's going to heckle you, or, you know, do you think about those things? What are the fears that you still currently have?
Yeah, I'll tell you, the only fear I have now, and it just makes, it's a fear that sharpens me now, is that I want to make sure that anybody I'm talking to, whether it's one-on-one or in a room, that I give them every bit of me, of my heart, of giving them information that can impact their life. That's where my fear is coming from now. And, you know, we have an event coming up. When I seen the theater, I went home, I got in the car, I called my wife, and all I said was, what a great idea to go meet and sit and talk in the theater. We could have did it at a Starbucks. But going to the theater and seeing the stage, I said, how I am so excited to dive in and see what we can do to help somebody in what we're going to talk about. And so one of the things that it was really instrumental in me really overcoming that was, you know, when a race car driver is going around a turn at high speeds, what they tell them is, you're going into the wall. Don't look at the wall. You have to, if you look at the wall, what are you going to hit? The wall, right? What was your fear? You were looking at, you don't want to lose everything you have because of your family, and I don't want to lose it, you lost it, right? You were looking at the wall. So what race car drivers teach you, if you're going to go to the track, and when they teach you, and what they're taught is, if you're going at 200 miles an hour and you're coming close to the wall, you turn and look where you want to go. You don't look where you're going because you're going to crash right into the wall. And that's where it is, where your focus goes, your energy flows, right? That's where it goes. And so that's what I started to do, is this is where I'm going. And instead of just kind of looking into the fear, I turn my head to excitement and who I'm going to help. And it kind of turns on like that servant's heart, where I cannot wait to get in there and do this now. And I only had that type of confidence, and it came to me kind of unconsciously when I was playing football and baseball. It just came to me. I just had it. I knew what to do. It took me a lot longer to learn this and learn, stop focusing on everything that's going to go wrong and focus on,
well put,
the other 100 people in the audience that are on the edge of their seat because they're going through some real things in their life, and that's who I'm reaching.
Yes, absolutely. It's interesting. I teach a lot of classes on things like overcoming fear, and mm-hmm. one of the things that I, and that's really a great point you make, the race car driver, that's really a really good example, and I like it a lot, and I think our audience can use that. One of the things that I do is I tell people, when you're fearful about something and you have to take it on and you have to do it and you have to overcome it, I tell them, and I always taught my children this, look at it as if you're going to climb to a top of a mountain, where when you get to the top of the mountain, everything is beautiful, the sky is blue, greenery, you can see for miles, it's beautiful. You have to treat it like every day you're going to start at base camp. You have this fear. So you're going to start down here at the bottom of the mountain. You're at base camp. Well, now you have to ascend this mountain. And you're fearful, oh my God, it might rain on me. It might snow. I might fall in a hole. There might be a landslide. It might be muddy going up there. I might get tired. I might run out of water. Like John said, you can find all the excuses why you're not going up that mountain, because it could be tough today. But you got to go. You got to take it on. You got to take on the bad weather, the good weather, the rocks falling, whatever it is. You've got to find a way to make it from base camp to the top of that mountain every day. And when you're taking on fear and you want to challenge it and overcome it every day, you've got to just act like, hey, I'm starting down here at the bottom and I'm going to the top. And yes, there will be challenges along the way, but I will overcome the challenge. I will be fearless. I will make it happen. And again, after that, I will go on to my next challenge. And the fear becomes less and less and less. Like I say, there are things that make us all fearful in life. Every one of us. There is nobody without fear. Maybe Conor McGregor is fearless. Mr. UFC. Mm-hmm. Maybe he's fearless.
Good at hiding it.
They're good. He goes about life fearlessly, I guess. So yeah. Anyways, there aren't many of us like that. But I want to thank you for being on the show today and talking about a really, really cool subject, because as we overcome our fears, we become better and better and better. And I know that you work at that every day and you talk to your people about it. In closing, do you have a couple more thoughts for us?
Yeah. The only thing I want to bring up is that, you know, you can overcome your fear once, but if you don't continue to to go into the fire, you see smoke, you walk towards the fire, that fear will come back. And I just, really quick, is I'm scared of heights, not being up high, but looking straight down. And my niece wanted to go on the Big Shot up the stratosphere, up the pin. And again, I almost fainted when I went up there with her, but she said, I'm not gonna go on unless Uncle John goes with me. And I wanted to be protective of her. I have a protective instinct, right? So I go up there, just standing up there, my legs went weak. I felt like I couldn't even hold myself up. I sit on this thing and I'm screaming at the guy working it. My harness isn't locked. My harness isn't locked. But the funniest thing happened is that thing shot up and man, I screamed like a woman. The whole time this thing bounced up and down. It goes shoots you straight up the pin and then it bungees up and down.
Oh God.
I was screaming far more than my niece. And then I get off the ride, and it was funny. As I get off, I said, holy cow, screaming like a woman, right? And this big muscle guy comes over to me, big guy. He goes, I was screaming like that too. I didn't even hear you. But what I want to get at is this, is that when I got off the ride, my legs felt as strong as ever. I was fine because I went into the fear. Problem being is I never did anything like that again. And even if on TV I see something going straight down, I get a feeling about it.
In your stomach.
You have to go after it every day. Like start at base camp every day, and you go after it.
Every day up that mountain.
You have a repetition.
Yeah, it's so funny that you say that. It makes me laugh. It's a great story. And you know we'll close up here pretty quick, but it's a fun subject. I took my daughter to one of the roller coaster parks and. I have a fear of roller coasters. Terrible, terrible, terrible roller coasters. Well, we went to Universal Studios, and they have a couple of crazy rides, Harry Potter and the Witch's Tomb or whatever they called it. And I told my little 9-year-old daughter, okay, I'm gonna go on these rides with you today. Well, they got pictures of my face and how I looked and the horror in my face. And my daughter's just like having the best time.
Yeah.
And this is the time, and there are times when you have something fearful happen to you that you say, I'm never doing it again. I don't care how fearful I am. I said, I am never, ever going on a roller coaster again with you. You can go with your brother, your sister, your mom, but I'm not going on this roller coaster. So, you know, fear is real. And sometimes fear hits us and, hey, in a thing like that, it's okay.
Yeah.
When it's life or death or decision, and a big decision has to be made, overcome fear. It's been a great show. Again, we'd love to hear from you. It's an incredible subject because it's in all our lives. The way we overcome it is by how, in the end, we judge ourselves and how we go forward and be successful in life. I want to thank you for being part of the show today. It's been a great show. John, thank you.
All right, my man.
You're an awesome dude, an awesome subject. Thanks for your great input.
Thanks for your post.
Oh, yeah, it's always exciting.
Good conversation.
And it's a funny post. I am fearless, but it brought a lot of attention. And please continue to watch our show. We enjoy it. We'll see you next time. Thank you very much. Be blessed. Talk to you soon.